Okay, welcome all, and thank you for joining the final AWRI webinar for the year. My name is Michael Downey, and in this session we review options for optimising your grape press. But before we jump in and make a start, a couple of quick reminders for anyone that is new to AWRI webinars. To provide a comment or ask a question, please open the Q&A section of the Zoom toolbar, type in your question and click to send it through. Also a reminder, this webinar is being recorded and it will be available to view via the AWRI's YouTube channel. Now, for those of you that have just joined, welcome. Today's webinar will be moderated by the AWRI's Dr. Simon Nordestgaard and also includes supplier recommendations for optimising your juice extraction requirements and equipment. So following four presentations, we'll be jumping into a panel style Q&A. But as I said, we're going to start off with Simon Nordestgaard. So terrific to have you on board today, Simon. And if you're ready to take it away, I'll pass it over to you.
Thanks, Michael. And thanks, everybody, for tuning in. So as Michael mentioned, we're going to have four talks first from me first, then Samuel from Bucher-Vaslin, Mathew from Tekmate, and Paul Baggio from Della, Toffola, and then we'll have a Q&A session. The presentations, we've pre-recorded them, and they should last about 35 minutes. Before we get into the Q&A. So I'll get straight in.
The pictures on my title slide summarise key developments in batch pressing configurations over the last 150 years. There were vertical basket presses. These were turned onto their sides so we could crumble the press cake automatically without having to take the press apart. There was a switch from pressing with plates to using a rubber bladder in order to press more gradually. Later, the bladder was replaced with a more robust membrane and put in a semi-closed tank with drainage channels and bigger presses then built. The ability to fill axially was added, allowing the tank to be rotated during filling and more juice to be drained. This removed the need for separate drainers and lifted throughput enough that even very large wineries that had previously relied on continuous screw presses could consider pneumatic presses as an option. This is the dominant technology in use today and will be the focus of this session. I guess, why do we need to optimize draining and pressing? Firstly, throughput. Despite those advances I mentioned over time, average throughput can still not be fantastic, particularly in white wine production. While some of the concepts presented today will apply to both red and white wine production, arguably draining and pressing are more critical operations in white wine production since they're occurring before fermentation, before the grape cells have already been broken down by that process. The press is also where we get our initial yield. If we don't get the yield then, this can't be resolved later. How we operate the press also determines the initial level of solids we have in our liquid. Those solids then need to be removed somewhere through the winemaking process. Pressing also influences phenolic levels and therefore bitterness and astringency. As we start getting juice from around the skins, the phenolic levels will increase. Pressing is also a key downgrade point in the winemaking process. We typically downgrade a large amount of juice as hard pressings. While it would be great to keep lots of different pressing fractions separate and blend them back as proofs to work for the wine, this is not a luxury most wineries have because of the effort involved and the availability of small tanks. Broadly, you could categorize these top four factors as being related to optimizing the draining and pressing programs. This last one is more about optimizing the choice of the press cuts, but although the press program itself can also influence this. Samuel's going to talk a bit about juice solids as well, but I just wanted to offer a few thoughts. At a really basic level, I've never really seen any great data explaining structurally where in the grape juice solids come from, but presumably they're the pulp cell walls and maybe some vascular tissues. the actual solids you you end up with in the juice will depend on how the juice leaves each grape, and then how many of those solids are filtered out by the cake as the juice makes its way to the drains. An example of the influence of how the juice leaves the grape on solids content is this solids content data comparing whole bunch pressing and versus crushing then draining and pressing. The solids content is much lower with whole bunch pressing because of internal grape filtration associated with the very gentle even pressing with the whole bunches. I don't think it relates to cake filtration because the cake is quite open and would be a poor filter. For larger operations, you probably don't have much of an option of widespread whole bunch pressing because most of the grapes have already been partially crushed by machine harvesting into stemming, crushing and pumping, but it's a good illustration of some of the phenomena involved. This data illustrates the second factor in juice solids levels, cake filtration. It shows the solids levels after filling through the door with either a static cake or versus axial filling with either rotations every 2 minutes or continuous press rotation. You get higher solids levels the more regularly you break up the filter cake. The solids levels increase by 35% by axial filling and rotating the press every 2 minutes, but you're able to fit 32% more grapes in the press because of the extra draining. But if the press was rotated continually, they got 57% more solids again, and they were only able to get 6% more grapes in the press. So it wasn't really worth it. This is only a little press, and while the numbers might not scale perfectly, the general principles do. This slide illustrates some different types of pressing programs. Standard press programs have one pressure level between each crumbling, with the pressure getting higher and higher to a maximum of around 2 bar. A sequential or champagne style program has multiple pressure steps between each crumbling. In 2010, Asika reported on a trial of inert gas presses. One interesting point they made was that on the side of that trial, they spent a bit of time optimising their other presses, and they were able to by playing around with the program, they were able to get the same yield as they had previously, more quickly with fewer solids. They said that they did this by increasing the number of steps in the program, but using shorter holding times and fewer overall rotations. I'm guessing that maybe they essentially changed their press program to be more sequential in nature. It would make sense that this could be useful, particularly early on in pressing when there are pockets of juice and you don't want to clog up the cake too quickly. I haven't done this myself, so I've put a question mark here, and in the discussion I thought we might talk about the merits of standard and sequential programs. Some manufacturers seem to adopt hybrid style programs like this, with sort of more sequential at the start than more standard at the end. With most press brands, you can and modern presses, you can adjust the different step parameters. The problem with working with grapes is that they're a natural product and there's variability between batches. There are different varieties. They can be at different levels of ripeness. The batch size can be different, and they may have undergone different harvesting and transportation conditions. One way to manage this variability is to have so-called self-optimizing programs that are not defined purely by a series of time pressure steps. All the major press manufacturers have long offered self-optimizing systems. Generally, they work by assessing the instantaneous juice flow rate, and using this information together with their own heuristics to optimize the pressing of that batch with respect to yield quality and duration. The basic principle is if the juice flow rate is still high, you might as well stay on that step you're on. But once it gets low, you're just wasting time and you might as well raise the pressure or crumble the cake. This data shows the prevalence of Australian wineries of different sizes with self-optimizing programs on one of their presses. And of those, how many people use them regularly? Depending on size, 20 to 40% of wineries had a press with a self-optimizing program. Larger wineries were more likely to have them, but relatively less likely to use them if they did. People using these programs were happy with them. When I asked people that had them but didn't use them why, some of the reasons were they can take a long time and the time varies. Some people were able to be at the press to monitor it. Some said it didn't make much difference. Others said that the user is more familiar with the local grapes. And some mentioned problems with flow meter accuracy and foam. Generally, the self-optimizing program concept seems good. And if buying a press, I would get this option. The different systems on the market are not necessarily equal though. And if I was buying a press, I would bring up some of these discussion points with the suppliers you're looking at to get their thoughts. So variations on those self-optimizing programs have been around for a long time. Recently, there has been some renewed focus on further automating presses, including in improving automation of filling and washing. This is a picture of Bucher-Vaslin's Maestro press and Della Toffola's AI press offers something the same thing, where they have load cells on the legs so that they can automatically measure the mass of grapes that have been loaded. Some of those self-optimizing programs have long given a juice literage or estimate, but not the tons loaded. With this, it should be able to automatically track the liters per ton yield. Rotary nozzle sprayers are another feature that is looking to improve automation. There are also efforts to better coordinate multiple presses to allow more continuous flow for large wineries. So these systems are available on the Bucher-Vaslin and Della Toffola presses, and probably other major press manufacturers as well. Another process that has been very manual in wineries is making the press cut. It is often based on tasting. It's not really been easy to fully automate it unless it is based on yield. And it's not an easy step to optimize manually. It's usually not practical for the winemaker to be there for the whole program, and typically only the last juice in the trough is tasted. It'd be difficult to judge what effect letting a little bit of extra juice through will have on the thousands of liters of juice already in the free run soft pressings juice tank. It is plausible that sometimes people would err on the side of caution and cut earlier than they really need to. As a hypothetical example, let's say that hard pressings juice ended up as wine that could be sold for a dollar less per liter. This table shows the lost revenue for a winery cutting by different liters per ton earlier than they need to for a total processing of 5 or 10,000 tons. If a winery processing 10,000 tons was able to push out the press cut by 20 liters per ton, they could earn $200,000 more. This is just a hypothetical, but my point is that the cut is a major point of downgrades and a very important step to optimize. So what tools are there that could help you decide on cuts and also help with press optimization more generally? You could measure phenolics spectrally. I've done many measurements of phenolic levels in white juice. You generally need to filter the samples beforehand. It's doable, but it's a fiddly time consuming process. And bluntly, I wouldn't bother unless there's an inline technique that's developed that doesn't require filtration. Another option is phenolics by voltammetry. Vinventions offer a portable unit for doing this. Doesn't need sample clarification, which is a positive. And this could be a useful tool. I haven't used it enough to be sure. It uses disposable test strips, which makes it very user friendly, but it means that it can't really be installed as an inline measurement technique. Electrical conductivity is another option. Essentially, you are measuring the changing level of potassium that's concentrated in the skins, like the phenolics. So it can act as a bit of a surrogate for this for each batch. Laboratory and industrial grade equipment are widely available at reasonable prices. The technique was researched and recommended after a project by the French Technical Wine Institute in Pirard in the late 1990s. They do note some of the limitations, and I'll discuss those after. And while not perfect, I think it can be a useful practical tool. There's also some inline color measurement equipment from Della Toffola and some under development by Wine Grid that could be an option. These are very very new at the moment. I haven't seen a lot of details, so maybe they could be useful. I don't really know it at this point. whichever one of these techniques you use, there might not be an easy answer on cuts. And I think this is one of the reasons why adoption to date has been poor. Firstly, every batch is a bit different. So there isn't always some magical cutoff value where you can say cut when the parameter gets above value X. The rate of change of a parameter could tell you something though. If the profile was like this, it would be a pretty obvious and easy to make a cut in real time. But often it's not going to be like that. You're going to be sort of like, should I cut now or now or now? If you're trying to do it in real time without a lot of other data available, this doesn't mean the measurement's wrong. It's telling you something about your process, namely you're not getting a very fractional expression. I do think that combined with other data and good logging, it could feed into smarter multi-parameter decisions though. I think developments that lead to better automated logging of data could help facilitate this. I also think generally that in big wineries, it's desirable to get presses hooked up to SCADA systems and logging data in a meaningful format so you can build up enough historical data such that informed decisions can be made. Maybe there ends up being a rule that for a certain variety, you essentially cut when the conductivity or rate of change in conductivity is a certain value, provided that the yield is within a certain range, that sort of thing. But you need the data to be confident doing that. And to be honest, whatever parameter you're doing this based on, whether it's conductivity or something else, you're probably going to face these same sort of limitations. You need lots of data and some sort of multi-parameter decision-making approach. One final point, when you're looking at data from presses, it can be useful to plot them against yield rather than time. Since it gets harder and harder to get juice out of the grapes as you go on, the profile can look quite linear when you look at it with respect to time, but be much more curved when you look at it against yield. These plots show the same batch of batches being pressed, drained and pressed, but on the left it has the time on the x-axis, while on the right it has the yield on the x-axis. Thank you for listening.
Okay, the next presentation is from Samuel Plumejeau from Bucher-Vaslin.
Hi, Sam here from Bucher-Vaslin. Thank you to the AWRI to allow us to contribute to this webinar on how to get the most of your back press. So when I started preparing this presentation with Simon, he mentioned that during one of the WineTech conference, a winemaker was mentioning how much benefit they got from having a technician on site and how by reviewing the way they use their press, they could get improvement on their quality, reducing their juice lees, whilst in fact not reducing their grape intake. So just wanted to quickly give you a bit of insight into what you can do on your press to do that. And at the end, I'd like to touch on pressing small batches, which is a question I often get for back presses. So first, let me ask you, do you want to use your press for pressing or for draining? The answer is both, but surprisingly, you may end up using it more for draining than pressing. Let me explain. So in Australia, most of the grapes are machine harvested, dumped into screw hoppers, destemmed, crushed, pumped into presses. By the time it gets to the press, it's already a lot of liquid. And that's why the press is first and foremost, in this case, a filter. When you do hand-pick fruit, of course, you can do hand-pick fruit very well with the back press, extract very gently and progressively with very, very little solids. But that requires hand-picking and gently transporting the fruit and using belts into the press. So let's focus today on how to optimize the filling for the mechanically harvested. So this graph shows here on the blue, it shows the flow rate. You can see three big peaks here. The green line that goes up progressively is the accumulated volume of juice extracted. And then finally, in the red, the curve that goes up and down is the pressure applied. So the point of this graph is to show how when you put your fruit in there, there's a lot of flow of juice. It's mechanically harvested, destemmed, crushed and pumped. So it comes straight out of the press in very high flow rate. So it shows you also how much volume is extracted. And in fact, if you look at the right-hand side of the graph, most of the juice accumulation is achieved before you even start pressing. So in effect, you are using your press mostly as a drainer or a filter. And when you think of that, that helps you organize your vintage. It helps you organize the size batches. It helps you provide good settings on your press. And let me just give you a bit more on that. What you want to achieve is you want to extract the juice out of your fruit mass. And in fact, the more you have fruit mass inside the press, the more clearer your juice is going to come out. And that's what you want to achieve. At the beginning, the extraction of juice, the juice is high in sugar and high in acid. You want to keep that going for as long as you can. Eventually, it will drop. This graph also shows that eventually, the more you have rotation and the higher pressure and more you break up the mash, more you start seeing an increase in potassium and polyphenols. So, but you want to have that right at the end of your extraction so that your free run is of the highest possible quality. And that's including in the dejuicing phase. So how can you achieve that? Well, ideally, you don't want any rotation at all. And static filling is what gives you the least amount of solids. But static filling limits also how much you can put into your press. However, the beauty of those back presses is you can rotate them by having a small rotation, not a complete one, just a rocking back and forth between door up and drains down, back and forth, back and forth. You have a limited amount of maceration. And every time you go up and down, you clear the drains and then you extract more. So that gives you an ability to increase how much you can put in the press without generating too much solid. And if the speed and volume you need to fit in the press becomes the priority over how much solid and juice lees you're going to get, and perhaps even acid or phenolics you're going to get, then you can do full rotation. And that is set on a timer, which most presses will have. So you can set the time with the drains at the bottom on 50 and drains at the top on 20. So that's just to give you an idea of the TATB. Obviously, the speed has a big impact, so you don't want it to go too slow. You don't want it to go too fast. If you go too fast, you're going to fill up your press, and you'll require a lot more rotations. So initially, you go by the rule of thumb, so 30 minutes for a 2-ton press to 8-ton press, about an hour for a 10-ton press to 32-ton press, and then allow an hour and a half for a 45-ton plus press. And that gives you plenty of time to extract nice, clear juice that's been filtered through the skins. So the three things to take home: let the juice filter through the skins. That's what's going to give you the best quality juice, but also it's going to give you the least amount of solid. When you do rotate, make sure you have the right speed of filling so you don't overfill your press. Aim for about 30 to 40 centimeters under the door, and set your rotations according to your aim. So if you want to go slower and get less solids, or if you need to go faster and put more in, just increase the number of rotation. Now, if you need help to do that, sometimes it's easy to forget how to do that in your press. It's very simple, and you can get your local service agent to help you, either get him to do a local service call, or online support is available if you've got your press connected. And you can also use the user manual. And finally, you've got Facebook groups and training programs online from Bucher-Vaslin. Small batch pressing. Just quickly on small batch pressing, we do small batch pressing programs. So essentially, you're using the same principle, but you apply less pressure. So bearing in mind that if your press is not full, you'll be extracting very quickly and you don't need that much pressure. So 0.4 bar is a fairly safe pressure, even though if you think about it, it's not such a light pressure. And so it really enables you to extract the juice safely in the back press, even if you have very, very small batches. Again, refer to your user manual that gives you all the different limitations and settings you can use for small batches. What I do use sometimes is I use an existing program and let it run until 0.4 bar. I know I'm safe and I've extracted the juice. So that's a nice and easy way to do that. And that concludes my presentation. Thank you for listening. Don't forget, you've got plenty more information from your service agent, bookofaslin.com, and all the social media.
So thanks, Samuel, for that presentation. Next, the next presentation is...
Hi.
is from Mathew Ross of Tekmate, talking about DME presses.
Optimising your grape press. From vintage 2018, DME has released the new and improved control panel, version 4.0. The upgrade features a new interface and PLC. The press optimization strategy changes the feeding procedure from static to dynamic, then switch to continuous rotation when the press is more than 80% full. More effective pressing parameters and the use of flexible programs specific for grape varieties. The most common mistakes made with presses is using the same pressing cycle program for all grape varieties. We aim to get maximum press output. The automatic feeding, pressing and washing phases include intelligent filling, MIP program, a deep washing and dual port discharge. We have intelligent filling. This includes reduction in the number of rotations during the axial filling of the press. It includes solid reduction, less oxidization, estimated filling level of the press, complete automation. This gives significant improvement in the juice quality processed. Identification with the pump on or off. Stop or reduce the rotations when the pump is not pumping off the product. Filling step by step, optimize the rotations during the filling cycle. A full press, measuring the filling level. Vent control, avoid sprinkling caused by excessive air pressure. Quantity of loaded grapes. Real filling time, indication and estimation of quantity of grapes, and a filling chart. A graph is displayed showing the main varieties to be checked. The intelligent filling system is autonomous and does not require any connection to the pump or to any other equipment external to the press. The MIP system. The intelligent system adjusts the maintenance time by measuring the loss of pressure on the membrane. A greater juice output corresponds to a greater loss of pressure on the membrane and lower recovery time. The example that we show between an MIP and a standard pressing program, we can achieve a time saving of about 10%. We achieve maximum extraction of juice, there is no operator intervention, and we optimize the pressing cycle. A deep washing or intensive washing system is the pulse jet washing option. That reduces the need for operators to climb into the press. Automatic valves are placed on the juice outputs, allowing the use of detergents. Dual port discharge, reduced feeding times and increased loaded product. These are available on sizes 150 to 750 hectolitre. DME, traditional and strong in innovation. Thank you.
So thanks, Mathew, for the presentation. Now, our next speaker is Paul Baggio from Della, Toffola. So I'll just start this presentation.
Hi, Paul Baggio from Della, Toffola. And today we're going to be presenting how to optimise pressing with the Della, Toffola central membrane press. Della, Toffola press now is about 30 years into Australia and New Zealand, and its unique technology is home to Yolumba, Casella, AVL, and a number of notable brands across the countries. The Della, Toffola press is designed with a central membrane bag. It differs from the traditional bag press, which has its membrane along the press wall. This affects, for the Della, Toffola, the ability to install drain screens across the full tank surface area. We'll be discussing today the differences in operation and how that implicates in the process, and how we can optimise Della, Toffola presses. By definition, as the presses are termed pneumatic bag presses, the impost of what pneumatic air supply is provided by the winery becomes a critical factor in the performance of the press. Does the winery have a suitable size compressor, air receiver? What's the distance of the air receiver and the compressor from the press? In particular, what becomes one of the challenging areas is where there's multiple presses connected to a single compressor or air receiver. What we find is the diameter of the feed line, or the the air feed supply line, is that suitable? And is it running in parallel or series? These areas are to be understood. From our experience, getting that right will determine how efficient and effective the pressing performance will be. By virtue of case study, some years ago, Punt Road Winery in the Yarra Valley, who had installed a Della Toffola 160 hectolitre press, which was the fourth press after a number of smaller presses were bought, was somewhat distanced from the air receiver. In that instance, we basically identified some differences between what was the actual program timing and what was the actual effective time ratio of the press program. And it was determined that because of the distance and the air demand occurring in the earlier presses in position closer to the air receiver compared to the Della Toffola, which was downline, that there was actually going to be cavitation or there was restriction to the supply. And this was actually incurring delays. In all matters of winery design, one of the key questions that get asked by cellar managers and winemakers alike is how to increase the cycle times of the press itself. A lot of this could be changed by moving from what is hatch loading of your grapes to what is via feeding your grapes via actual feed. Yet to achieve this, there needs to be communications between what is the actual feed on the press to what is the distemper crusher and the must pump. There have been variations of this. For us, we tend to prefer connecting what is the transducer in the press via a communications port to the actual feed gate valve that is communicating directly to the must pump. In this instance, a far more instantaneous supply of communications that closes the gate valve in the event of getting close to a full press load occurs. More accurate still would be the supply of waste cells across the four presses. In the latest design, Della Toffola, in our intelligent press, AI, artificial intelligent press, what happens, we actually have four weigh cells across each four footings that calculates the weight distribution to the press itself. This is, of course, the most accurate form of determining what is the weight installed into the press and determining to the gate valve on the actual feed line when to stop and close. Just a side note on the subject of what is actual in-feed loading of bag presses, we tend to prefer what are gate valve closure systems on actual feed lines compared to pinch valves. Over the years, we've noticed cavity displacement pumps operating at times 6 and 8 bar pressure will tend to basically push through pinch valves, not making them as full safe as they should be. As pictured in the slide, a traditional axle feed line should be using a gate valve as pictured. Another area that has crept up into winery engineering design that could be having an impact on the efficiency of loading bag presses is where local engineers are retrofitting in localized control of the actual feed and communication line. As pictured in the slide, here's an example of a press where locally have actually instigated bypassing what is the factory communication line between the transducer to the gate valve. In these instances, what we tend to find are instances where bag presses are either not as effectively loaded as they could be. Further to the conversation of press turnaround times and cycle speeds, one of the biggest restrictions to a press's ability to turn around faster is the manner by which it discharges its mark. Often, the preferred design is a screw conveyor or a belt conveyor. Both these designs have limitations. Often, belts slip or burn out and need changing and repair, and screw augers, subject to the diameter of the auger of the screw and the motor drives, each have their own issues. What we're finding is many times what works best is where we actually position the press higher in the air. This enables no restriction underneath from which the mark gets discharged to, and that means the press can just function efficiently on its own merits without any concern for belts or conveyors burning out or needing to be repaired. Attached in the slide are some examples, and most recently, I think over the last four installations, all presses have been installed elevated, enabling the mark to discharge to ground. In this way, either discharge directly to a truck and tray or using a front-end loader to mobilise the mark away to what is a waiting truck. In this instance, the press can function to its cycle without any disruption or concern for what is occurring below. Water waste has become quite a subject of interest, and of course, once dumping mark to either belt, conveyor, or the ground, The subsequent washing of presses and the water discharge from those presses combining with the mark has always been a concern. Please find attached here an example of how we have a pneumatically driven collection tray that goes underneath the press to collect and wash water. That water can be harnessed and retreated, you know, filtered for reuse. A lot said on intelligent programming, yet what I would recommend is winemakers to truly investigate how intelligent the programs are. What I find is that many programs require a set point input, such as 600 litres determines a cutoff point. And thus, by default, they've actually got now three fractions. What we find is that these flow meter driven, litres dictated intelligent programs aren't in themselves intuitive. And there are today a lot more other forms of artificial intelligence systems that would be better placed. Hope you found these tips for optimising the Della Toffola Press informative. If there's any further information required, don't hesitate to call us at Della Toffola Pacific or by the emails attached. Look forward to seeing you in harvest. Cheers. Hey, Paul Baggio from Della Toffola.
Okay. So thank you to all the presenters for taking part in today's session. From here, we're going to move into a panel style Q&A, and I'm going to bring each of the presenters back in a moment to take part. Please be aware that if you do want to ask a question, open up the Q&A part of your Zoom toolbar, type in your question and click to send it through. We've got about 20 minutes or so before we need to wrap up. So yeah, plenty of time for any questions you may have.
Okay. We haven't got a huge amount of questions yet. I might just start with one for the different presenters. I guess I mentioned a bit about thoughts or standard programs where there's only one pressure set point between and then a crumble and then a different pressure set point. And then there's those sort of sequential or champagne style pressing programs where there's multiple pressure set points between crumbles. I guess I was interested in the different suppliers' perspective on what they think of those different approaches and, you know, how common they might be in different wineries. Maybe I'll start with Paul and then then everybody. So Paul, what's your thoughts?
Sure, thanks, Simon. Look, we have within the press elements of both the standard sequential programming, and certainly we have winemakers who are using each. It becomes quite that challenge or that balance between yield versus polyphenol wine quality in many instances. I guess that notion you raise, once the solids, and I'm talking suspended solids, are generated, you've got them. So subject to the winery, and particularly larger wineries, we're seeing a lot more interest and focus towards cycle times that are minimizing the level of suspended solids generated. And in that instance, I guess the program that would have, less impost would be the sequential style programming. It just lets less stops and starts and less. But that said, it just comes down to the ability to drain. And I guess with our press, we get quite a large fraction above 600 to 700 litres of free run. And I guess this part for us accounts for what is that second fraction or what they call low press. So certainly it is a debate, but it is playing out in our mind between the tension between what is reducing your friction and that balance between suspended solids versus polyphenol and yield.
All right, thanks, Paul. I'll go to Samuel now and then Mathew. So Samuel, what are your thoughts on some of those different styles of programs that a winery could use?
Yeah, thanks, Simon. From my perspective, the first type of program that you mentioned where it goes pressure on, pressure off rotation, and just goes to one level of pressure and just keeps repeating the same thing and then rises. That's probably historically the more ancient or the older type of program. But the sequential program is, in my view, more versatile, allows you to really control the tools that you have at your disposal, which is basically pressure and rotation. So whereas the sequential allows you to really control your sequence, the automatic program doesn't really. So in other words, with the sequential program, you can actually do the same as an automatic program if you want to, but also you can start with that or finish with that, and then in the meantime you can have several incremental pressure rise. So I think definitely the sequential is more versatile. I'd say that the first type of press program is more prevalent for reds, also in cases where the fruit is already pre-drained quite a lot. So if you've got already your 600 liters per ton before you start pressing, then you know that might be a good option to start with. But the sequential is always nicer at the end. But you would only use a sequential, for example, for a whole bunch. So definitely sequential is more versatile. That's the one I use the most personally.
So you said then that you'd only use a sequential for whole bunch, like a purely sequential, but would you use it? Could you use it for machine harvested and crushed grapes as well? Or are you saying essentially you wouldn't use that style? You'd go back to your standard automatic program. Just to confirm on that.
The sequential gives you the ability to do pretty much all the types of programs. So I usually by default I go to sequential because I can control everything there.
Everything. And Mathew, what are your thoughts on that topic?
Over the years, I've seen we've put in both put in a lot of sequential program or flow meters and the load cell programs. But I guess the customers over the last few years have probably gone back just to their basic standard programmings because they've liked to control the time and the programs themselves, so they know what time it starts, how long it runs for, the number of rotations, and when it finishes. So they're in total control of the program of the press.
Yep, fantastic.
So that's what I've seen probably more yep. now.
All right. Yeah. Thanks, Mathew. We're getting a few more questions coming in, so I'll start asking some of these. The first question here, I'd be interested to understand your panel's view on the concentration of polyphenols and the impact on wine quality. I could answer a bit. I might go to the panelists first. I'll start with Paul. Paul, again, what's your thoughts on that?
Sure, it's a very good question in the sense that your presentation again, or in actual fact, I think it was Samuel's mentioned, what do you buy the press for? For us, our press is designed very much the Deltoff press with the full tank covered with drain screen, very much like a champagne press. And the focus is to separate the juice very rapidly from your grape mark. The basis is of the theory is that in the skins contains your polyphenol oxidized enzymes. And the quicker you can separate the liquid juice from those enzymes, the reaction with oxygen will diminish the browning fractions or the concentration of browning fractions and hence oxidation. So I guess for us, it's a primary or principal part of the design of the whole press to create what can generate more free run, which most winemakers would associate with high quality juice. That comes back to that question about, from polyphenol concentrations, the faster you can separate, the juice from the grape skins, the lower they will be. And for us, as to the specifics, it comes down to grape variety. But generally, why we tend to prefer, for our larger volumes, what can be actual feed in feeding of the press becomes because we can quickly separate, in feed the grapes, separate the juice, and hence reduce the concentrations of browning fractions and oxidation.
All right, thanks, Paul. Mathew, do you have any thoughts on that, on the impact of concentration of polyphenols on wine quality? I guess
I've seen limited rotations during filling. Probably the DME have increased the number of increased the slots in their drainage channels, and the dual port discharge on their presses so that they can get the juice out of the press.
Yep. Yeah. All right. No worries. And it's Samuel, do you have any thoughts on that topic?
The actual impact of the polyphenol on the winemaking itself, I would say the press, the job of the press is to separate the juice from the fruit mash as quickly and as cleanly as possible. So for me, the idea with the press is to add as many automation as possible, where the winemaker can taste the juice out of the press. You know, basically they can have their decision made at that point in time. When that's not possible, and you touched on that before, you can try to measure a phenolic in line. So there's a number of projects going on to try to do that more efficiently. But if you go back to a more traditional way of automatizing that, you can also use your track record, you know, just for wineries that do repeated batch of particular varieties, they know basically when they start getting phenolics, whether it's a liters per ton or when they reach a certain pressure, because that's the more you have pressure, the more you're starting to extract from the skin. And so that's where you start seeing the phenolics towards the end of the extraction. So yeah, that's there are ways to automatize it and to try to optimize, you know, how much free run you get from your whole load. So that's where that becomes interesting in the press settings.
I guess generally from my side, I guess in answer to that question, I guess it's depends on the style of wine you're making. Whether the impact of polyphenols is negative or contributes positive aspects. I mean, at a simple at an applied practical level, I mean, there's going to be you're probably trying to minimize them, because you're often in a bigger facility where maybe you're going to get a certain amount that's just goes along with the process. So they're probably more of a negative a component that you're trying to minimize.
Use the downstream processing, correct, Simon? If you're going to
that's right.
I guess that's where the concentration of oxidation, you know, the use of gelatin downstream aids is what I guess a lot of winemakers are trying to, reduce at the very least. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah. That's right. Like. I think that's I think that's probably summarizes it. I think. But yeah, it's like with a lot of these things, you know, a little bit of it could be a positive thing with one's wine styles, but in probably larger wineries, you're trying to minimize it. Okay, we've got some other questions here. Can you recommend any pressing aids besides rice hulls for machine harvested fruit? I'll start with Samuel this time. Samuel, have you got any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I guess the idea is to add products in the fruit to help with the pressing. Enzyme are always helping, but you know you have some limitation with that as well. Other than that, really, there's not a lot of pressing aid that we are familiar with.
So, one comment on that, because I know you guys have sold into apple juice production and things like that, and instead of pressing aids, you've in that sort of there's not a lot of cake structure in when you've got crushed up milled apples, so they sometimes you had like fingers that went into the press to try and create structure and drains. But is that ever sold into the wine industry? No, or not really.
Yeah, some people do use drains with those fingers that you're talking about, particularly for those grape varieties that are hard to press. So for example, Semillon or very late harvest or ice wine or, you know, that sort of fruit mash that doesn't give the juice so readily. So having those fingers, you're extracting juice from inside within the mass of fruit, and that helps. But you mentioned the apple. in the apple industry, they do use enzyme to facilitate the extraction of the juice. So that's definitely, you know, similar to the grapes in that regard. But as you said, you require even what we have in the apple presses is a long loop of fingers with a sock material that filters the juice so that you're extracting from the inside out as well.
I suspect, Simon, that inquiry may have come from the US. It's very prevalent to use the rice hulls, you know, in part of the press through the US, but not so much here in Australia. I don't think we've seen much of that at all. So it's
Maybe if I can add, in a small scale winery, you can even consider adding stems. Some winemakers do put stems in the press to help extracting more juice. You know, that's I've seen that a few times. That seems to be a one trick.
I guess when people used to not de-stem a lot in white wine production, didn't they? When they were using drainers and stuff like that as well. I know some big wineries that, yeah, they used to not just use what stems were already there. Yeah.
Well, obviously with vineyard de-stemming becoming much more prevalent, we're seeing what is the equivalent of a pea soup now end up in our presses. And sure, you know, that it comes back to that first question about the press cycles, I think now becoming far more of interest because the use of stems, big winery or small, is just becoming less common in the actual tank press itself.
Yep. Mathew, do you have any thoughts on, have seen any pressing aids in use or sort of?
No, nothing to comment on.
Nothing to comment on? No worries. Okay, next question is, can the use of pectolytic enzymes at the press reduce the extraction or slow down the flow of free run juice during the draining operation? I'll start with Samuel this time. Do you have any thoughts on that topic?
Yeah, enzyme, they will help for the extraction. If you add them in the press, they probably have less time to be active. So perhaps adding them a little bit beforehand gives them more time to do their job. But also they can be in the red pressing. In my experience, the addition of enzyme for Pinot Noir extraction is quite beneficial in terms of how it facilitates the pressing of the Pinot Noir. And I'm mentioning Pinot Noir in particular because we find Pinot Noir pressing is probably a bit trickier than the other grape varieties. And also probably has to do with how long the fermentation on the fermentation goes on, if it's a long or short fermentation for those the Pinot Noir. But I'm talking about red wine Pinot Noir, of course, in that case. So that's where I see enzyme providing a benefit, as well as for the white. But for the white, it would be pre-press rather than in the press.
Yes. Mathew, do you have any thoughts on that, on the use of enzymes? That's all right.
No worries. Sorry.
And Paul?
Sure. Look, I guess the question of enzymes, you know, is renowned for extraction, but I think the biggest focus there needs to be the pre-treatment. Again, similar to what Samuel was alluding to, you know, really what you'd be looking for is additions that are happening at the receival bin into the crusher destemmer. There's a lot of systems where we're doing injection of liquid enzyme so that the residence time, it's either that, again, that tension between having to go to 8 grams a litre versus, you know, what is a traditional form of dosage rates to get an effective use. And the other one's temperature. What we're finding is, again, those who are looking for that extract need to have that pre-infrastructure, tube in tube, for example, to warm up and to have some sort of impact. Because the enzymes, again, if you're dealing with white grapes being yielded, recovered or received to the winery in the morning, a lot of them at 5 and 10 degrees C aren't as very efficient as they would be. So I guess my only comment on that is, without a doubt, they do, you know, give a yield and an impact, but a lot of it will come down to how your pre-structure to the press is designed to really have an efficient, effective use of enzymes.
Yep.
I think also with an enzyme, you could have some some negative impact on the amount of leads that you get. You know, so if you have the same batch, one with a you know, higher enzyme treatment than the other, and you process exactly the same, there's good chances you'll get more leads on the batch that has more enzyme, just because it releases more skin cells and more solids, which you then have to remove. For every kilo of solid that you remove from your must, you also lose some must in the process. So it's a double whammy, so to speak. So you have to be mindful of that. It's always a compromise between the speed of extraction, the amount of solids that you get, oxidation time. So, you have the tools to do that. So, it's worth thinking about it. It's worth thinking about, you know, how many rotations, how often you do them, and how fast you pump into your press. Sometimes you get better result by pumping a little bit slower.
Yeah, sorry, Simon, I'll just add to that. I think probably not knowing the details and the question specific, but I think the one aspect is slipskin varieties, musket, for example. I think a lot of the guys in our warmer climate regions who are using bag presses, they without doubt would be using enzymes to help deal with slipskin. And, in that instance, without doubt, you know, that sort of balance between trying to provide residence time for the enzyme to react and deal with things like muscatel, and certainly our customers up in Mildura and Riverland have all had to go through those processes of using various forms of the various enzymes that specifically deal with polysaccharides and your colloidal aspects before it's extracted through the press.
There's sort of that use of enzymes, there's excluding Gordo, there's always been that bit of debate about whether you do it after pressing, and because it's about clarification, or whether you do it at intake. And you know, some people are worried about getting phenolic extraction in the press, and I could probably in the end, a lot of people, they end up adding some at the crusher and then topping it up as needed to make sure things are pectin negative before clarification, and they end up doing more for the pressing. So it's always, I don't know, I haven't really ever seen great studies on the effect of enzymes on yield, apart from like really old stuff when people did seem to show that it had an impact on yield. So we're probably running out of time. So really appreciate all of your input for this session, and thanks everybody for attending. And I'm sure if anybody's got any questions, feel free to email any of the me or any of the attendees, and I'm sure we'd all be happy to help. So I'll pass back to Michael, and he'll sort of wrap things up and talk about probably the next webinar. So to you, over to you.
So I'd like to first thank all the presenters. So thank you to Simon, Samuel, Paul, and Mathew for taking part in today's session, and also to Simon. Thank you also to all the participants who joined in today's session. For all attendees, you will receive a follow-up email which will contain a some information about where you can get hold of today's recording, as well as the option to fill in a survey. Acknowledgements also to Wine Australia for providing funding and support for webinars via the AWRI Extension Project. And also a reminder, the next AWRI webinar is on Thursday, the 28th of, that should say January. And reviews methods for botrytis grey mould detection and estimation in grapes. So if you're interested in registering for that session and you haven't done so already, please visit the AWRI website. And finally, from everyone here at the AWRI, wishing you all a safe and festive holiday period.